Good day, everyone. Welcome to Crime Talk. My name is Scott Reich. Yes, it is Sunday, and this is a recap of all of the top stories throughout the week, conveniently located in one location. Yes, you are welcome. I hope you enjoy it. Leave me a comment below, and we'll see you next time. And first on the docket. So Judge Fran Gull said that a petition to the Indiana Supreme Court calling on her to be removed from the Delphi murder trial should be thrown out due to the defense not using the proper legal avenues to seek their legal goal. Now, Judge Gull wasn't alone in calling for the high court to throw out the petition, as the Indiana Attorney General Todd Rokita echoed many of Gull's same sentiments in a separate filing that also asked the court to reject the petition. So both Gull and the Attorney General's office here in Indiana called the writ of mandamus filed with the Indiana Supreme Court, the legal petition that not only called for Gull's removal, but for the reinstatement of the accused murderer's Richard Allen's original defense team, improper, stating that Allen should have pursued an appeal if he thought Gull was abusing her power by removing the original defense team. In the Attorney General's argument that the writ of mandamus was inappropriate for pursuing the reinstatement of legal counsel and that the appellate process is the adequate and preferred way to present these arguments, not a writ of mandamus. Now, Rokita, the Attorney General, pointed out that Allen didn't appeal these actions or file a motion to disqualify despite having the opportunity to do so. They wrote, quote, "A writ is inappropriate because Allen has a remedy through the appellate process. He can file his motion for change of judge, and if denied, he can appeal that decision." Now, Judge Gull also echoed this sentiment in her own response, citing the court decision that said, "Writs are often used as a shortcut to an appeal which cannot be done." One of the main reasons the writ called for Judge Gull's removal was due to her decision to remove Richard Allen's original defense team, Bradley Rossi and Andrew Baldwin, from the case. Now, Gull cited gross negligence in this decision, which came in the wake of evidence leak traced back to Baldwin's office that led to another man's arrest. Now, Allen argued his Sixth Amendment rights were being interfered with by the decision to remove his original defense team. Both Gull and the Attorney General argued against this, however, with the Attorney General writing that while defendants who cannot afford their own counsel are guaranteed representation via the Sixth Amendment of the United States, the amendment does not provide the defendant the right to choose their appointed counsel. So the Attorney General and Gull went on to say that contrary to Allen's claim, there are circumstances that require a court to interfere with a defendant's choice in counsel. One of those instances appears to be here, according to them, gross incompetence. The judge argued that she was well within her power to remove Baldwin and Rossi due to concluding that the pair committed multiple violations of the rules of professional conduct, in addition to compromising Allen's defense due to evidence and a leak, finding them being negligent and incompetent. Now, the judge drove this point home further by saying that Baldwin and Rossi failed to take responsible steps to safeguard confidential case materials, citing the leaked crime scene's evidence. Not only were the photos laid out in Baldwin's office conference room, providing the opportunity for Baldwin's former co-worker, Mitchell Westerman, to take photos of the evidence, but the judge wrote that Baldwin would share with Westerman information about the case to obtain Mr. Westerman's feedback. Gull cited further examples of the pair's incompetence, including Baldwin sending an email about the case to the wrong Brad instead of Brad Rossi, Baldwin and Rossi making statements to the media that included information that would not normally be revealed, and Baldwin and Rossi providing false information to the court about Allen's reported condition in prison. The Attorney General also weighed in the transcript on October 19th, which is the meeting between the defense team, Gull, and the prosecutors. In the meeting, Rossi and Baldwin claimed they were pressured into withdrawing from the case by Gull. The Attorney General stated that in the hearing, Gull listed the reasons why she felt Rossi and Baldwin should be disqualified due to gross negligence as a result of the evidence leak. When given a chance to argue their side, Rokita, the Attorney General, said that Rossi and Baldwin withdrew rather than challenge the factual allegations. Judge Gull also argues that she gave the pair ample notice about the consideration of disqualifying them from the case, citing letters that mentioned the possibility or disqualification sent more than a week before the October 19th hearing. And the judge also echoed the Attorney General's finding that Rossi and Baldwin had opportunities to be heard on the record arguing against disqualification. Now, while Allen argued bias against him due to Gull's decision to remove Rossi and Baldwin, Gull said her decision to remove the attorneys doesn't show bias, but rather demonstrates her concern to ensure that he had competent representation. Now, in the conclusion of both filings from the judge and the Attorney General, they asked the Indiana Supreme Court to deny the writ filed on behalf of Allen, which would mean the marching forward to the late 2024 trial date, where Mr. Allen would be represented by a new set of attorneys. So this gets interesting. Whenever there's an extraordinary writ filed, you go to the Supreme Court and say, hey, this is such irreparable harm. It needs to be addressed now. The courts don't have to take it, but if they do, they're usually going to do something of significance. That's why generally of all the extraordinary writs that go to a state Supreme Court, roughly 2% actually are granted. So the issue here is, should the attorneys have not got off the case, appealed, that could take months/years. In the meantime, speedy trials ticking away, or do they need to do this? Yes, Mr. Allen does not have a right of choice for his attorneys, but if that's who he wants and there's not a conflict, you would think that the attorneys should be allowed to stay on. I'm telling you, I read that transcript. I've never seen anything like that before in my life. I think everybody messed up in this particular situation. If the judge thought that the attorneys had screwed up, there's a remedy for that. Hold them in contempt for violating the court's protective order, or in the alternative, she files a grievance with the attorney regulation committee in that particular state and deals with it that way. But once again, then she creates the record. Is she creating problems or protecting the rights of the defendant? Only we will find out here shortly in the next couple of weeks. And as I noted, Thomas Westerman. Mr. Westerman has a charge of one count of conversion. That is a fancy legal term for theft that was filed against Mr. Mitch Westerman in Johnson County Superior Court. That is apparently a Class A misdemeanor. And so he does face the possibility of some jail time. And it alleges that he knowingly and intentionally exert unauthorized control over property of another. Now, like I said, in the murder case, Richard Allen was arrested back in October of 2022 and charged with the murders of Abby Williams and Liberty German. Now, attorneys Andrew Baldwin and Brad Rossi were assigned as his public defenders, and Allen had pled not guilty to the charges. Well, Baldwin is the founder of Baldwin, Perry, and Riley PC, also known as the criminal defense team, with offices in Franklin, Indianapolis, and Noblesville. Now, Brad Rossi is a partner with Hillis, Rossi, and Dean of Logansport. And according to records, Mr. Westerman worked at Baldwin's law firm from 2015 to 2017 as a legal assistant and an operations manager. Now, although Westerman no longer works there, both he and Baldwin reportedly said he still stops by from time to time. And then in a sworn affidavit dated October 18th of this year, Westerman said he visited Baldwin's law firm several months ago. While waiting to meet with Mr. Baldwin, Westerman saw photos from the Delphi murder case on a conference room table and took photos of those photos. Now, Westerman and Baldwin both stated that neither Baldwin nor Rossi gave him permission to take the photographs. And according to the affidavit, Mr. Westerman shared the photos with a man from Fishers, who may have served in the Indiana National Guard with Mr. Westerman. The unidentified Fishers man apparently shared the photos with an unidentified Texas man, who then shared them with a podcaster. Apparently, the podcaster notified police once they became aware that the photos were prohibited from being released, but of course they'd already been published. Well, the Texas man who sent the photos are mentioned in the affidavit, but is not charged. Now, the Indiana State Police were reportedly notified on October 5th and began their investigation. Now, according to the court records, Westerman admitted to Baldwin on October 9th that he had taken the photos and shared them with the man from Fishers. And then on October 12th, the Indiana State Police investigators allegedly went to the house of the Fishers man to question him about the leak. The man wouldn't answer any questions without an attorney present, and hours later, apparently died by suicide. Now, at an October 19th hearing that we discussed previously, Judge Gull announced that Baldwin and Rossi were withdrawing from the case because of evidence leaks. Now, an initial hearing for Westerman has not been set as of yet. That's right, the Alec Murdoch sentencing. We brought it to you live here today. Well, the sentencing, this is the opportunity for the victims to speak and explain how the conduct of Alec Murdoch has affected all of them. And since it was a financial crimes case, this was about trust. The judge, Judge Newman, said this was a crime about trust. And every one of these people talked about how they felt so betrayed by Alec Murdoch. And then when Alec Murdoch spoke, he should not have spoken. Now, good thing it was a stipulated sentence. He was going to get 27 years unless he got up and said, I didn't do it. But he said he did. And then he went through the stroll down memory lane talking about how we went to school together. And your daddy hunted with my daddy. And everybody was good friends and they trusted him. And he violated that. He has no soul. He is an evil individual because he would do that to people that he knew. Now, one of the gentlemen that got up and spoke had a great question for Mr. Murdoch. Some $20 million has been stolen. Where did it all go? He didn't spend it all on OxyContin, ladies and gentlemen. There's no way that that could have taken place. Where did the money go? Everybody keeps talking about all the money that was stolen, but they've never really traced it as to where it all went. Now, Mr. Murdoch, once again said, he gave a very painful statement in allocution. And as a defendant, he has the right to say anything he wants. He always gets the last word, so to speak. And of course, he denied killing Maggie and Paul, and he admitted that he'd done wrong, and he's going to get his 27 years. And his attorneys should have stopped him immediately. But he just can't help himself from keep talking. Even when the judge finally sentenced him, Judge Newman finally sentenced him, said 27 years, and basically, Mr. Murdoch, you have no soul, you have no conscience. He had nothing to say. He goes, Mr. Murdoch said, I got nothing to say, and then turned around and said, I just want to reiterate what everything I said to everybody. He cannot help himself. He is the epitome of a con man. He thinks he can just get away with anything and that he can sweet talk everybody in this situation out of their money and their forgiveness, etc. But I'd still like to know, where did that $20 million that has been stolen from those 100 cases that are all now resolved? So we know how Alec Murdoch now has two consecutive life sentences for the death of Maggie and Paul, 27 years on the state cases. He's also pled guilty and awaiting sentencing on the federal cases as well. The reality of it is, it is a life sentence. Mr. Alec Murdoch is going to serve anywhere between 75 and 85% on the crimes that he pled guilty to today, assuming somehow he gets a miracle and his case gets reversed on the homicide cases. He is still going to be in his 70s before he'd even be eligible for parole. He is going to die in prison. Let me know what you think. 27 years. Was it too soft? 27 years. And he's going to have to serve 75 to 85%. Let me know. Are you tired of Alec Murdoch? And I do remember, we've got the video. It was that one case. I said, hey, because I have a home down in that area. And I said, this is interesting. This little boat wreck, this little boat accident with Paul Murdoch. And here we are, 3 years later. Good little story, my little humble opinion.
Chad Daybell had a motions hearing. Couple of issues. First, the court is going to allow cameras in the courtroom. Now, it's not really the news media's cameras or photographers. Once again, the court is taking over and saying, I will control the cameras. I will control the microphones. But guess what? That is good news. That means that we, the public, get to see the trial in real time. Not like the Lori Vallow trial where we had to order the audio at the end of the day. Now, needless to say, once again, the prosecution didn't want any cameras in the courtroom. Their argument is it could intimidate witnesses. Well, guess what? Being on a witness stand is intimidating in and of itself. And frankly, they won't even notice that the cameras are there. Now, the court also heard argument on the change of venue. Remember, the prosecution wants to move it back to Madison and Fremont counties there, but the defense wants to keep it in Ada County. The argument for the prosecution is simply, it's too expensive. It's always about the money, ladies and gentlemen, but justice is expensive. Give the man his fair trial. It's set in Ada County. Let it commence in Ada County. Let's get this show on the road. The other issue is the death penalty. Arguments were made in regards to the death penalty should be removed from Chad Daybell, just like it was for Lori Vallow, basically because there were discovery violations as it relates to Lori Vallow, and she was unwilling to waive speedy trial. So the judge imposed a sanction on the prosecution, said, I'm not going to allow you to go forward with the death penalty because it's just not fair. Now, Chad Daybell is saying, hey, it's not fair that he waived his right to speedy trial and asked for a continuance so that his counsel could prepare, and therefore he could potentially get the death penalty simply because he asked for more time for his attorneys to be prepared. We'll see what the judge rules. I personally think the death penalty probably is probably not going to go away, and I think it's going to stay in Ada County. But at least we have cameras in the courtroom. That's good for everybody. One more thing on Chad Daybell. As you may recall, we brought you the motion, I think it was a couple of weeks ago, about the prosecution trying to clarify whether there were any orders that kept Chad Daybell from speaking with his wife, Lori Vallow. As you may recall, at one point in the proceedings, the defense wanted to have a joint conference between Lori Vallow and Chad Daybell. The attorneys were there to try to see if they could resolve the case short of trial. The judge said, no way are we doing that, creates all kinds of issues. Prosecution wasn't thrilled about it either. But Lori Vallow went to trial. She was convicted on all counts and sentenced to multiple life sentences. Now the prosecution wants to clarify if there's any orders that would prevent the two from communicating with each other. And the court said, I'm not aware of any. It was just that one meeting that everybody wanted to have, and I wasn't going to allow that to take place. But now they can communicate as much or as little as they want. My advice is, Chad Daybell, listen to your attorney, but don't communicate with Lori Vallow. She is bad news, and anything you say can and will be used against you, because let's face it, they got enough bad evidence. They don't need any more.
Lori Vallow is on the move. That's right. Lori Vallow is now sitting in an Arizona jail. She was extradited from Idaho overnight, and Lori Vallow is already obviously serving multiple life sentences in Idaho in connections with the murder of her two children, JJ Vallow, 7, and Tylee Ryan, who is 16, as well as her fifth husband, former wife, Tammy Daybell. Now, Vallow's initial court appearance took place in Phoenix, where she faces charges related to the death of her fourth husband, Charles Vallow, as well as conspiring to kill her niece's ex-husband, Brandon Boudreau. So the Maricopa County Sheriff's Office confirmed that Vallow was transferred to the Estrella Jail. And at this morning's court appearance, the judge set an arraignment date for next Thursday, December 7th. As noted in the Arizona case, Vallow is charged with conspiring to kill Charles Vallow, who police say was gunned down by Vallow's brother, Alex Cox, back in July of 2019, there in Chandler, Arizona. Now, as you all know or may not know, Alex Cox died before any charges could be filed against him. And Lori Vallow is also charged with conspiring to kill or murder Brandon Boudreau, her niece's ex-husband. Now, according to police, Cox shot at Boudreau's Tesla on October 2nd, 2019 in Gilbert, Arizona, the bullet just missing him by a few inches. So here we go again, ladies and gentlemen. We know Lori Vallow is obviously serving multiple life sentences, obviously conspiring to kill her husband number 4. I guess the big question is what will be the first motion filed by the defense attorneys? Will it be competency? Will it be NGRI, not guilty by reason of insanity? Or will it simply be, can we make a deal? Is that going to be the conversation with the prosecutors? Let's make a deal, something concurrent with her case in Idaho, or do you think she's going to go to trial? Let me know in the comments below.